We're doing everything from space situational awareness to maritime domain awareness to battlefield awareness. Again, the Office of Naval Research handles both Navy and Marine Corps science and technology. So where other craft are on the water, where other airplanes are in the sky, where other soldiers, both friend and foe, are on the battlefield, that's a critical area for us now. Finding out where things are and who they are and what they do is very important for us. I'm Walter Jones. I'm the Executive Director at the Office of Naval Research in Arlington, Virginia. One of the things that my program officers are expected to do is understand what the current state of the art in their technology field. And for now, the best way we have to do that is to come together at a conference like this and see what other researchers are doing, see what industry is doing in the exhibit area, to argue with each other, to talk about new developments, breakthroughs, to go back home and try something new in your research. Still, the best way we have to keep current is to go to a conference like this one here. There are night vision issues, as you described. There's flexibility, ability to do different things with the same sensor. Size is a big issue as well. The more sensors I can put into a particular area, that's important for us. Interoperability is important. So a lot of areas related to sensors, but it all comes down to just gathering information in the most efficient way that we can. Sensors do almost too good a job of gathering information. It's honestly more than we can process. So a related area to sensing is information processing. How can I sort through all the information that sensors can bring to the table? And ideally do it in an automated fashion. If I can find an automated way of sorting through to get me down to particular things I'm interested in looking at or understanding, then the analysts can more focus their efforts on particular things that they should watch for. So the automation and the information processes is a big but related area to sensors. Directed energy, though, seems to be the way everyone agrees that we need to go for a lot of reasons. So we're working on lasers from the small laser that you saw there to a much larger laser that might be used for a ship self-defense on an aircraft carrier. So we'll see. A lot of work to be done. That's a very difficult thing to do. I mean, keeping a beam focused on an object for long enough to burn the hole that you want to burn in is very difficult. So we had a successful technology demonstrator. There's still a lot of work to do to take that forward to something we can deploy on ships in the Navy. So we're working that. In areas like sensing and certainly information processing, the commercial technology is far outpacing what we can do. So I think our ability to leverage their investment. I mean, for information security, we're interested, but so is Bank of America and other banks. So how can we leverage their investment in commercial technology to then spin off into our military technology, and then focus our limited resources on those things that commercial industry will not do? So it's sort of an understanding of what, and again, at a conference like this, you get the picture of both military and commercial investment and how those two might fit together. There are two ways it works. One is technology push from the bottom. If we have a new product that we've developed through our naval S&T research, sometimes we'll look for a small company that might pick that up and run with it. A lot of that work is done with small business, in fact. So sometimes it's pushing a product to market that might have both military and commercial applications. But in other cases, it's requirements pull from the customer. We work very closely with our systems commands, both in the Navy and the Marine Corps, to understand what their gaps are. If they have a particular thing that they would like to do with improved sensing capability or information processing capability, they'll state that gap to us and we'll look around our technology portfolio and propose a solution back to close that gap potentially. And again, it all depends on the time frames and new systems in which we might insert that technology, the availability of funding. So it's a very difficult and complicated process to work through, but it's both. It's technology push as well as requirements pull from our customer. If it's something that meets a gap from the customer, you're typically looking at a 2-, 3-, 4-year time frame before it's inserted into a program of record. Those tend to be more evolutionary in nature. But we're also looking at capabilities that we think the customer might need 10, 15, 20 years down the road. And those can be game-changing, completely out-of-the-box technologies that either bring an increased capability or bring a similar capability to greatly reduce cost. Cost is a big driver for what we do now as well. So it's both performance and cost that we must consider as we look at transition of technologies.